Good morning. My name is Dennis Dorr, a retired pastor from the Presbyterian Church, enjoying being a Methodist this morning. I'm glad to be here. John is enjoying some family time today, asked if I could come and be with this part of his family while he's with his. And I'm told that there's also some reception family time after the service today. So you're welcome to stick around. Those of you that are here and enjoy some fellowship together afterwards. And those of you that are online, if you hurry, maybe you could get here in time for the fellowship time after the service. We would love to see you. Greetings. So welcome. We're pleased that you can be here on behalf of John and this congregation. Welcome, and we trust that you'll experience God's presence and find your faith renewed as we worship together. So let us begin by reading responsively the call to worship from Psalm 18. We love you, Lord. You are the strength of our lives. We call on you. You are worthy of all praise. The Lord lives. Praise be to our rock. Jesus is our rock, our sure foundation. So let's sing of that and his promises. Hymn number 374, Standing on the Promises.
Standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing.
Let us join our hearts together in prayer. Pray with me, please. Lord, you've made a lot of promises in the Bible. You promised that you would never leave or forsake us. You promised that you would complete the work you began in us. You promised to be our refuge and strength in times of trouble. You promised to save us and deliver us from the powers of sin and death. We stand on these promises today and place our lives in your hands. You have never broken a promise, and you never will. So we place our faith in your goodness, power, and love, and praise you, our risen and present Savior. Amen. To invite children of all ages to come forward for a little children's story this morning.
See a whole lot better. Come on up. Oh, here it is.
There. How are you? Just kind of have a seat right there. Right there. Yeah, that's good. You know what this is? You know what this is? What is this? Say it real loud. A log. This is a log, and it's up on a bank, and there's a big pond down here. And Goober wants to roll this log into the pond. If he can roll it into the pond, it will be a great thing to play on. They can jump off it, they can hide underneath it, and they can lay out and get a suntan on top of it. So he found this wonderful log, and he wants to push it into the pond. And he tries, and he pushes as hard as he can, but he can't do it. Ah, I need some help, said Goober. I'll help, said Tiny. Oh, you're too little. Get somebody else. I'll help, said Buggy. Okay, let's push. And they pushed, and it didn't go anywhere. Hey, we need more help, said Goober.
I'll help, said Tiny.
No, you're too little. Get somebody else.
I'll help, said Brigid.
Oh, good. Okay, let's push. Everybody push. Nope. Need more help. Get some help.
I'll help, said Tiny.
No, you're too little. Get somebody else.
I'll help, said Bullfrog.
Oh, good. Let's push. All right, everybody together. It's a moment. Keep going. No, we need more help. Get some help.
I'll help, said Tiny.
No, you're too little. Get somebody else.
I'll help, said Dad.
Oh, good. Let's all push together. They got ready and they pushed and they pushed. And they push in. Nope, doesn't work. We need more help, said Goober.
I'll help, said Lily.
You're too small. Get somebody else.
There isn't anybody else.
Oh, all right. Well, let's do it one more time. Push hard. And they all got together and they pushed and they pushed and they pushed and in went the log. And they all jumped in together.
They said, oh, that's great.
Hooray, hooray, we pushed the log. We pushed the log in the pond.
And Dad said,
well, you know, we couldn't have done it without Tiny.
Yeah, said Tiny, I'm the strongest little frog in Frog Pond.
You know, sometimes doing God's work takes big people, but it takes tiny little people too. And everybody is needed to do God's work. Let's pray. God, thank you for big people and little people. Thank you for the work you give us to do. Thank you for friends to help us do that work. We pray that you would help us all to do our work, whether big or little. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Okay, thanks for coming up.
This morning, I don't have a list of prayer concerns or items, so I'm going to give you a moment if you would like to share something that I could note. Otherwise, I'll lead us in prayer. Are there particular concerns or items of thanksgiving that you'd like to remember today? Yes, John? Bill? We'll pray for Bill, friend of John's who is quite ill. Others? Yes, sir? Yes, welcome. Did you bring the humidity today? Yes. What is your first name? Okay. And again, I didn't get your first name.
Paul.
Thank you. Welcome. I'm glad you can be here and feel welcome to stay with your brother as long as you want. Okay, anyone else? Yes, Linda. Babies that are born that have medical problems. Okay. All right. Pastor John and his family. Okay. All right. Oh, yes, sir. Your granddaughter's 29th birthday. Well, that's a reason for celebration. How many of you had a birthday this last year? What, nobody? Are you all dead? Sure, you've all had a birthday this last year. So we celebrate life. Okay, then let's go to prayer. We thank you, gracious God, for your loving presence, that wherever you are, there is life. We have celebrated that this week and this month and this year. Thank you for the life that flows within us and enables us to be here and to enjoy one another in your creation. We thank you for the life of new babies. And there's so much hope involved in that. See a new grandchild or a great grandchild. We thank you for the life in those children and pray that you would continue to sustain it and protect it and help us to know how best to nurture it in good ways. We thank you for your help with us in daily living, for wisdom that you grant us as we make decisions. Thank you for direction and guidance that you show us. We thank you for your love that surrounds us. We thank you for the peace that you give us. And we would pray that you would grant us again your peace and your love and your wisdom as we continue to live our lives now. We pray for Paul particularly. He has a need for a home. I pray that as he's found a home in the church, that you would help him find a home in his living place, and ask that, as you've said, you would care for the smallest of our needs. So this is a big one. We pray that you would help him find that. We also pray for those of us that have medical issues and concerns. We remember Bill, but all of us know someone that's been ill or that's recovering, recuperating. Maybe we're here today, and we would turn to you and ask that you would renew life within us and within these people, that you would strengthen their bodies physically and renew them spiritually, that they might be mindful that you are good and that you are present and that you are help for them in time of trouble. So we give you our thanks. We lift up this service and pray that you would speak to us as we as we sing and as we hear your word, and that together we might be mindful of being your body and your living presence in our world. So hear our prayers, these spoken and now these that are unspoken, as we pray silently. Lord, we thank you for hearing our prayer, for delighting in our presence. And we conclude this time by praying that prayer you taught your followers to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Let us bring ourselves and our offerings to the Lord at this time as an expression of our worship together. Thank you. together. Thank you, O God, for the wondrous gifts you give us, most of all for that life that we have in Christ, your loving presence. So accept these gifts of thanksgiving. They're small and but a token of that which we indeed appreciate. Accept with gratitude these things and accept us for your service. For we ask this in Christ's name. Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning. By the way, if you happen to see Shirley moving around up by the piano, she won't be doing an interpretive dance. There are honeybees on the other side of the wall there. And John has informed me that some of the bees are getting in. There's some evidence of that. So good luck up there. You grew up on a farm, so you wouldn't probably be intimidated by a bee. Which Shirley and I are going to share with you a hymn called There's a Wideness in God's Mercy. It's in the hymnal at 121, but you don't have to turn to it because I'm not going to sing that melody. I'm going to sing the melody that's found on page 325, Hail Thou Long Despised Jesus. If you were to scan the many very interesting indexes at the back of our hymnal, you would see that there are a lot of texts, hymn texts, that have different melodies associated with them. And there are a lot of melodies that have different texts associated with them. As a matter of fact, if Shirley were to play bum 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 bum, you would think she was playing the introduction to Crown Him with Many Crowns. You'd probably be right, but there are three other hymns in our hymnal that we have today with that melody. So there's a lot of mixing and matching, and this particular combination of melody with text is popular in Great Britain. I went to YouTube and listened to about three or four choirs, all from England, singing this combination, and I liked it enough so that Shirley and I are going to put them together today.
There's a whiteness in God's mercy, like the whiteness of the sea. There is kindness in God's justice, which is more than liberty. There is welcome for the sinner, and more gracious for the good. There is mercy with our Savior, there is healing in his blood. There is no place where earth's sorrows are more felt than up in heaven. There is no place where earth's failings have such kindly judgment given. There is plenty for redemption in the blood that has been shed. There is joy for all the members in the sorrow of the head. For the love of God is broader than the measure of man's mind. And the heart of the Eternal is most wonderfully kind. If our love were but more faithful, we should take him at his word. And our lives would be thanksgiving for the goodness of the Lord.
Thank you, John. It's always a treat for me to come and hear you. And I have I have adopted one of the things that you do here so well. And that is to give a little background, a little history about the hymn, the author, or the tune as I go and do services in different places. And I find the people very interested in that. And so I want to thank you for that little addition. It certainly adds, I think it adds meaning to the music and to the hymn when we sing it together. Recently, I've been thinking a little more about limits. Let me explain what I mean. My wife had another stroke about 6 weeks ago. And we're glad that we're here, but those of you that have had strokes or know people that have had strokes know that one of the things that you find is that you can't do the things that you used to do. And some of that may come back, as I think we'll be fortunate. Linda was a little weak on her right side, but that's coming back. But it's caused me to pause for some moments and to think a little bit about living within limits. I also do services at a number of different senior institutions. And so this message grows out of my experience and reflections with Linda, but also out of my time with those people. You are much more able and not as limited as many of those people that I talk with. However, none of us know what life will happen, what will happen, and some of us may find ourselves limited by life in a variety of different ways, and then need to figure out how are we going to cope with that, and how are we going to live within those limitations of life. So I've selected a passage from Philippians chapter 4. The Apostle Paul was experiencing some limitations in his own life. These particular limitations happen to be financial, but they could be of a whole variety of different kinds. And I've chosen a couple of verses where he talks about the secret of living within his limitations. Now, we all have to live it. You know, we can fight against not being able to walk, but you know what? Most of the time, we're not going to be able to walk. The issue is, how do we live at peace within our limitations? And that's what Paul talks about in this passage. He's not talking about breaking through those limitations, but rather recognizing that life has limitations. And how does God strengthen us to be able to live within them? Listen for God's word to us today. I rejoiced greatly in the Lord that at last you renewed your concern for me. The Philippian church had supported Paul financially a number of times. They had fallen on hard times. They weren't able to do that as they had been previously, but that situation has changed. And they recently sent Paul a gift of money along with a person who would stay with him and help him in his ministry. So he's writing Philippians as a thank you note to them for this gift of money and the person, and he's sending it back with the person that they sent and expressing his gratitude. Indeed, you were concerned, but you had no opportunity to show it. I'm not saying that this because I am in need, for I have learned to be content whatever the circumstances. I know what it is to be in need, and I know what it is to have plenty. I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. I can do all this through Christ who gives me strength. Let me underscore his lesson. He had learned one thing. He says it twice. I have learned to be content, whatever the circumstances. I'm not sure I could say that today. He says it a second time. I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation. And then he talks about being well-fed or hungry, being rich or poor, plenty
or in want, in every situation, he has learned the secret of being content, at peace, a sense of well-being in spite of what's happening in his life. What a wonderful secret to learn. And he says he can do all this because I can do all this in verse 13. I can be content in any and every situation through Christ who gives me strength. Notice Christ gave Paul the strength to live contentedly and at peace with the limitations of his life situation. This is the first part of that serenity prayer, isn't it? God, grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, courage to change the things I can, and wisdom to know the difference. Grant me the serenity, the peace to accept the things I cannot change. That's what Paul is talking about here. Christ wants to give us peace as we bump into those limitations in life. And unfortunately, just when we get used to it and at peace, oftentimes they change. You find yourself without a home. You find yourself unable to walk as you used to. They change and we have to adapt again. We realize again that we're human. We're not gods. We can't control life. We don't have power over everything. Notice Paul said he had learned this. This is something that doesn't come easy. This is something that takes time. And I would encourage you, as you find yourself bumping into limitations, be gentle, be kind, give yourself time to learn. You didn't learn your math facts in just a day. It took you time to go over and to learn those things. So Paul says, God will give you strength, but this is going to take time. So we need to become students. Now I want to use Philippians chapter 3, verses 13 and 14, a couple of verses from the previous chapter where Paul describes his attitude toward life and I think gives us some insight into how Christ has given him strength to be at peace and to live with his limitations. As I said before, this is particularly for those who are elderly, but I think the lessons really are generic and apply to all of us. But my illustrations are primarily for those of us as we're growing older. Okay, these are the verses. But one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining toward what is ahead, I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. First of all, forgetting what is behind. God gives us strength to let go of the past. To let go of the past. Some of you may have had spouses or homes or cars or health or friends, and you've lost some of those things. There's new definitions of life, new restrictions because of these losses. Now, some of them you might get back, but oftentimes you won't. These are new limitations. And you have to live with that. And you're so mindful of the things that you used to have. You know, the past is very much alive and it's easy to dwell on it. Paul calls us to forget about it, to leave it behind. He tells, and you can tell whether people are living in the past after having conversation for about 5 minutes. What are they talking about? Are they talking about the losses that they have, all the things that they don't have, how life was so much better last year or last month, or are they talking about present day things? Paul says, forget about what lies behind. We have to let go of the past. Not that we don't appreciate it, not that we haven't learned from it or we're grateful for it, but we don't live in it. We don't try to recapture it. In India, they trap monkeys by using a jar
And in that jar, they put some palm nuts. And the mouth of the jar is just big enough for the monkey to be able to get his hand in. But when it grabs the palm nuts and makes its fist, it can't get its hand out. And so the monkey is trapped and runs around on the ground with this big jar on its hand, and they're very easy to catch that way. The monkey isn't smart enough to let go of the nuts and take his hand out. And sometimes when we're living in the past, we've got a hold of the past and it's nuts. It's nuts, folks. Let go of it. Let go of it. Take your hand out and live in the present. I know it's hard. It's grief. It's hard to let go. But there's no peace unless we do. And Christ gives us strength to let go. To let go of the past. And one of the ways that I find that this happens is, instead of focusing on what we don't have, we focus on what? What we do have. We become, we're not sorry and miserable people living in the past, but we're hopeful people, appreciative people, aware of what we do have. For example, if I tell you this, don't think about an elephant. What's the first thing you think about? An elephant, okay? And when we think, when I tell you, don't think about the past, what's the first thing you think about? You think about the past. But if I tell you to think about an ice cream sundae and how good it tastes, you think about an ice cream sundae and you don't think about an elephant anymore. And so if we can be grateful and appreciate what we have today, albeit maybe less than what we had, but appreciate what we have, then we will be more grateful people and we'll be able to let go of the past. The second thing that Paul talks about has to do with the present. He says, straining toward what is ahead. We need to embrace the present. Do you know there's no expiration date on abundant life? Jesus said he came to give us abundant life and to give it to us richly. He didn't say it ended when we turned 65. He didn't say it ended when we turned 80. He didn't say it ended when we had a stroke and have to live in a wheelchair. He didn't say it ended when you were unable to drive anymore. Abundant life has nothing to do with our health. It has nothing to do with life situations. It has nothing to do with age or ability or resources. Abundant life is defined by the presence of Jesus. He is the source of abundant life. He never leaves us. Abundant life is with us. Maybe it's in a different form. Maybe we have to learn how to experience it in a different way. But it is present. I think our task as we grow older, particularly with limitations, is to realize that God will give us strength to discover new purposes in our lives now. To discover new purposes. God still has use for you, so let's get going. May be different, it may feel uncomfortable, but let's do it. God is not finished with us yet. Now, I don't believe that it's easy to find new purposes when our health deteriorates, when our resources dissipate, or we don't have the ability to do the things we used to do. When so much of what our identity and activity has been is now no longer possible. I don't think it's an easy task. But I do think it's the task of growing older and an important task and living within limits. And I would suggest two things. These are generic. These do not have to do just with growing older. But oftentimes our activity clouds our lives so much that we don't focus on these as much as we should. First of all, I think we need to live in love. As we get older, we need to live in love. God called us to be patient, kind, forgiving, You know the list from 1 Corinthians 13. And we can still work at becoming more loving people. I think God's transforming grace continues to transform us into kind, appreciative, loving people, even when we grow older. And you know, if you talk, you know people like that. You love to be around them. They're an inspiration to us. God is more concerned about who we are than with what we do. Hear me. God is more concerned about who we are in character than what we do in terms of activity. Activity without love is nothing. So let us be light and let us share love and peace and hope no matter what our life situation. That's one of the new purposes that you can embrace. Another one is to walk, not only to live in love, but to walk by faith. The greatest journey, I think, of old age is to walk by faith. We have to trust others far more than we ever had to do. And that's not easy. We have to learn to trust God even more. Psalm 147, verses 10 and 11 say this: God's pleasure is not in the strength of the horse. It's not in how many resources you have. God's pleasure is not in the legs of the warrior. It's not in the health that you have. The Lord, rather, delights in those who fear him and who put their hope or their trust in his unfailing love. To have faith in the goodness of God, to have faith in the presence of God, to have faith in the love of God, in light of growing limitations in your life, is the work of faith. And that is the task that we have that pleases God. It's different from our activity, but it pleases God and he helps us with it. The third part of this task is seen in Paul's words where he says, I press on toward the goal. God gives us strength to live into our new futures, to live into the new futures. Christ calls us heavenward for a great finish. I want to encourage you to finish well. You don't run a marathon of life 25 miles and throw up your hands and sit down and collapse on the last mile. Finish the race. Finish. Keep going. Christ will help you finish the race to be people of hope that look forward to that which you have. And as you have that, you will be at peace within the limitations of life. Derek Redmond was a member of the British track team in the Olympics of 1992. Happened that those Olympics were in Barcelona, Spain. Redmond had just missed being in the Olympics by fractions of a second the previous Olympic time. So having made the team this year was very important and significant for him. The 400 meter race was taking place. Redmond was a sprinter. He ran fast. He had completed two heats and run very well. He had made the semifinals. So for those of you that are not track people, 400 meters is once around the track. So it's a pretty quick sprint. You run pretty much all out to get around the track. It's a very fast race. And it's a race with some notoriety. If you run a 400 well, people think you're a good sprinter. So he and Redmond is in the semifinals. He's at the starting blocks. The gun goes off. He jumps out of the blocks. It looks like if he runs the pace that he's at, that he will certainly be in the finals. He gets about
a third of the way around the track, and then he hears a pop and then awful pain in his left leg. His hamstring has popped and has torn, and he can hardly walk. He is limping. The other sprinters are leaving, going on around the race, and he is hobbling along. The medical people run out to him to see if they can help. He waves them off. He's gonna finish the race, and he limps along. Finally, the race is over. The people have been cheering. They've been watching the finish, and now they realize that Redmond is still there. He's over half, he's barely halfway around. And they see him limping along, and the crowd starts clapping and cheering. And then it looks like Redmond is about ready to sit down, that the pain is too great. When out of the stands, his father, Jim Redmond, comes, runs through the crowd, down onto the track, puts Redmond's arm, his son's arm, around his shoulder, and the two of them walk and limp slowly the last 100 meters, and they finish the race. And the crowd goes crazy. They talk about it. You can look at it, you can watch it on YouTube. Just Google Derek Redmond. You can watch the race and see what happened. The crowd went crazy. You know, most of the people don't remember who won that race, but they remember Derek Redmond and how he finished the race. Christ says, I will help you finish well. He will come alongside of us. We don't know what kind of pain or suffering may be involved. We don't know the challenges of the last lap, but we do know this, that Christ will see that we have all we need to finish our race, even if it means all we do is lean on him. If we do, we will finish well. Christ comes to give us strength, to help us let go of the past, to embrace the present with new purposes, and to live well into the future and finish our race. And knowing this helps us be content in life, helps us live within the limits, no matter what our circumstances. So may God grant us grace to live within the limits and know the peace of Christ. Amen. Let's pray together. We thank you, God, for your love and grace, and pray that as we continue to live on, that you would be our source of strength to help us live within the limitations that life presents, to do it in such a manner that we honor and reflect your goodness and grace. So grant us your strength for this great race. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's conclude our service by singing Precious Name, hymn number 536, verses 1, 2, and 4.
Oh, brother, and joy of heaven.
Receive God's benediction. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the unending love of God, and the fellowship and communion of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forevermore. Amen. God bless you.
The Lord be with us as we walk along the homeward road in silent thought or friendly talk, our hearts beneath.